BBOR Black Box Online Radio, coming to you from West Virginia. Black Box Ned 88 on Instagram for the bonus podcast. All right, and just one quick announcement before we start. It is October now, and it is approaching the end of the month, and we do a monthly Zodiac Killer Q&A session on this channel. We've done one for October, and we'll be doing one for the beginning of November, the next month. But since you guys have been leaving so many excellent questions and comments on this channel, I thought it would be nice to do a few other things. The first thing I would say is that throughout the duration of this recording, I will pull up some of your questions and comments about Shel Cavalli, a Zodiac killer suspect that we'll be discussing. And the second thing I would like to say is I would like to use this as an opportunity to perhaps do something at the end of the month, like an AMA, Ask Me Anything, where you can just drop some questions or comments about anything that we talk about on the channel. We talk a lot about the Zodiac killer, but also serial killers, true crime, mysteries. And we've also been doing some things about paranormal investigations recently, and we did that series on JFK and the Mossad. Any subject is fair game on this channel. So if there's any question that you would like to ask about anything true crime related or just an open discussion, AMA, Ask Me Anything, we'll hopefully do it at the end of the month, and we will read all of these off. So, with that being said, you'll see here that this is listed as part two of our discussion on the Zodiac Killer suspect, Shel Cavalli. But if you haven't heard part one yet, you can keep listening, because we're just going to be talking about the Zodiac Killer and the suspect, Shel Cavalli, as well as the researcher, Mike Rodelli. But I hope you'll go check out part one at some point throughout, at the end of this recording. All right, so let's get right into things. Then the first thing I would like to begin with is by saying that it is almost unfair of me to be very critical of Mike Rodelli, because I have not read all of his writings. But he is very, very adamant about a particular Zodiac suspect named Shel Cavalli, the Norwegian immigrant who came over to the United States of America when he was 10 years old, born in 1919, came to the U.S. around 1929. And I'm almost tempted to say that Rodelli is guilty of confirmation bias, looking at a lot of very, very, very bold circumstantial evidence. I would say, though, as I've been reading through the reviews of his book, The Hunt for the Zodiac, I noticed that everybody is just saying extremely praiseworthy things. They're saying that he did excellent research. They really commend him for using the case files, primary source documents. But I have to tell you, if we look at things from a different perspective, I really find that I have a lot of questions and comments that I would ask him myself about his Zodiac killer suspect, Shel Cavalli. And I said we were going to be talking about some of your questions and comments. So let's just jump right over here to some other things. This one is coming to us from Andrew WVA, and this is talking about Shel Cavalli as a Norwegian immigrant. Mr. Cavalli's European accent was noticeable from an audio clip I heard. Nancy Slover never reported this in her account when she took the Zodiac's phone call. Excellent point. Shel Cavalli had a very pronounced Norwegian accent. Nancy Slover made the bold statement that the person she was speaking to on the phone, who was claiming responsibility for the murders, did not have an accent. An unusual speaking cadence, I believe is exactly what she said, but not an accent. And Professor Stewart has weighed in on this as well. Thank you to you guys for the comments. This one's from Professor Stewart. I can't say I find this suspect compelling. The accent is the major problem. I think Brian Hartnell never described an accent of this type in his descriptions of the Zodiac. Neither did Nancy Slover or Cecilia Shepherd. One could argue that the Zodiac might try and disguise his voice while calling to taunt the police, but it's highly unlikely that he would have disguised it at Lake Berryessa since he was intent on killing Hartnell and Shepherd. Nevertheless, I'm really glad you did give every suspect their due time, Ned. Okay, big thank you to Professor Stewart there. But the point is, I think that that is something that we really have to look at. It would be rather easy for somebody who was very fluent in the English language, as Shel Cavalli was, to disguise his accent during a brief phone call. This is the Zodiac speaking. I killed those two kids last year. I mean, when he's saying like three or four sentences over the phone, but to have this full drawn out conversation and Brian Hartnell not recognizing anything like this, as far as we can tell, I mean, I'm just going to go out on a limb and say that whoever was talking to Brian Hartnell at Lake Berryessa was most likely a North American of some sort. I mean, Soren Korsgaard weighs in and says that we need to be looking for a Canadian national or somebody who spent their childhood in Canada. That's still North American all the same. And I think that that is a major problem with trying to connect Shel Cavalli to the Zodiac Killer mystery. And we have a question that comes in from Phobos Idemos Argentina, who says, who were the blue meanies that were mentioned by the Zodiac? And that question can be answered by Pedro Fernandez, who says, for the record, blue meanies were the Alameda County Sheriff's Department during the Cal Berkeley and anti-Vietnam War protests. So we mentioned how this term has been used in a couple different movies. I think somebody left a comment saying it was in the Beatles' Yellow Submarine, but Pedro says it's the Alameda County Sheriff's Department. And Pedro is a former police officer from California himself. Now, we have some other things that we should look at about Shel Cavalli. And this one comes to us from Colonel Reb, who says, he's too old to be the Zodiac. Now, think about what we said about Shel Cavalli at the beginning. He was born in 1919, right? I'm going to do some very fast math, and I'm going to try and guess that he would have been around 50 years old in 1969. You know, we're talking about 1968, beginning with Lake Herman Road and concluding in 1969 in Presidio Heights with the murder of Paul Stein. He would have been around 50 years old. That is rather old for the age of a Zodiac killer suspect. When we look at some other people, I mean, the oldest suspect we've ever talked about on this channel has been George Hill Hodell, whom I believe would have been around 68 at the time of the murders. And George Hill Hodell is, of course, Steve Hodell's suspect in the Black Dahlia Avenger case. And I don't think there's any possible chance that George Hill Hodell was the Zodiac killer. And I mean, the Zodiac killer wasn't 68 years old. Was he 50 years old? I would have to say that that is also something that goes against Shel Cavalli being a Zodiac killer suspect. Most people are looking for some guy in the age range of 25 to 40, or even if you're going to entertain the multiple perpetrators theory, that there were multiple killers, this is some type of group, this is the hoax theory, still the same age ranges, 25 to 40. The youngest suspect we've ever talked about on this channel was Louis Myers, who was 17 at the time of the first crime. And the way that I understand that this would have had to have functioned is people just simply overlook the fact that the perpetrator could have been much younger, age 17, and that this was all orchestrated by a teenager. But we've talked about many things over the course of the last 2 or 3 years on this channel, and it really appears that we're looking for somebody who had a very high understanding of mathematics and the sciences, perhaps something like engineering. And you see with Shel Cavalli, he is a very intelligent individual. And that's another thing we need to say. I mean, we just need to say a big rest in peace to Mr. Shel Cavalli, because if we weren't talking about the Zodiac Killer, I would be studying this guy in business class. I mean, he sold more than 1 million automobiles. He has this, you know, immigrant rise to riches story when he's just like, he was one of very influential with the sales of Jaguar and Volkswagen on the West Coast. You know, he was a trailblazer, it seems, in the world of auto import exports. I mean, I would just be wanting to learn about that if I were, once again, going to some type of business school. And as he gets tied into this, we have some other things that we should say about that, because we have a comment that comes to us from NPC Porky, who says, I would like to believe that somebody like Cavalli was not the Zodiac. I mean, why would a wealthy businessman be a killer, going around by himself, putting his freedom and wealth on the line? Generally, when a wealthy person wants to kill someone, they pay another person to do it. Also, if you think that Cavalli was hiring someone to do the killings while he wrote the letters, that also does not make any sense. And let's just stop right there, because Porky's comment goes on for a little bit. But, well, let's just ask and answer the question. Why would a wealthy businessman commit a series of murders? In that particular instance, after going through several true crime cases on this channel of a similar nature, that's more about the thrill killing. When a wealthy businessman commits a series of murders, this would definitely be down the thrill killing pathway of somebody who has all this power, all this wealth. They can do anything they want. They can buy a boat. They can buy whatever car they want. Shel Cavalli sold 1 million cars in his lifetime. I mean, he has access to many kinds of resources. They can go scuba diving at any place on Earth, shark diving, mountain climbing. Where is the thrill for them? And that's what leads to people, what leads people to things like forms of the thrill killing aspect, the thrill kill club, even as this expands into the multiple killers theory. And some people might even try and tie Shulkavale and something called the Four Horsemen theory, which we'll talk about on this channel. But on the other side of the coin is, I mean, let's not kid ourselves. Very influential business people work a lot of long hours. This whole thing about the CEO sitting in the back room smoking cigars while all the employees are toiling away. Real life doesn't necessarily seem to be like that all the time. A little bit, I'm sure. But I don't necessarily know if that's enough to connect Shulkavale to this 100% based on profiling. I'm so on the fence with the psychological profile of Shulkavale for some things that we're going to say in this, but I do think it's a very, very insightful statement. Why would this businessman risk all everything that he's created for 4 incidents in Zodiac Activity, this thrill kill crime spree in 1968 and 69? And the only possible thing that I can even think of is just that. This is like some type of thrill killing from a rich person or an aspiring entrepreneur. And someone who is just up and coming, and he had nothing else to do. But one of the things I would like to say is we have an article here from the Los Angeles Review of Books that is going to be talking about Shulkavale and Mike Rodelli, the Zodiac Killer researcher. And they even say in this article, I just want to share one thing, that at the age of 92, Shulkavale started piano lessons. And, you know, he's just a very active individual, but everything that he's active with is mostly benign. Yes, he's into things like racing, but, you know, he was a kid. He talks about in the video on Tom Voigt's channel how he would spend time with horses when he could. And I'm not 100% convinced. Like I said, I'm really on the fence about the psychological profile for a very good reason. Okay, and let's read a little bit from this article from LARB, Los Angeles Review of Books. On June 26, 1969, a wealthy car importer of Norwegian descent named Shulkavale wrote to the editor complaining that the paper was supporting militants and lawbreakers and warning of a bloody confrontation if society didn't shape up. This rant might be read as a reactionary piece of fretting typical of the late 1960s, but Mike Rodelli saw an ominous voice. He learned everything that he could about the author and spoke to him directly, concluded that he was most likely the Zodiac Killer, and he has compiled years of painstaking research into a book, The Hunt for Zodiac, The Inconceivable Double Life of a Notorious Serial Killer. And the reason why I said I was on the fence about the psychological profiling of Shulkavale, when we talk about other serial killers, they often have a very gentle fake facade. Like we mentioned Herb Baumeister, the I-70 strangler, who's just so like, all I want for Christmas is world peace. Like, I mean, when you hear all these things about Shulkavale, like as we said, liking horses, taking piano lessons in his 90s. I mean, and just some of the other things about, like, that we'll read in this article here. He is just somebody who just seems so gentle. But is Rodelli right and this is all a facade? Let's keep going. After discovering the forgotten Chronicle letter, Rodelli's next logical step was to find a photograph of Cavalli from the late 1960s to compare it to the police composite sketch. And, I mean, we got to have more evidence than just that. So many people will match the composite sketch. Cavalli's home in Pacific Heights was a few blocks from where the cab driver, Paul Stein, had been murdered. Rodelli then tried to trap Cavalli into giving him a handwriting sample by sending him innocuous questions through the mail, but he received only a typewritten note in response. And we're going to go ahead in the article to something that I think is very valuable. Okay, and they're saying that this is when Shulkavale is actually questioned about being the Zodiac. Shulkavale came out a few minutes later, an affable-looking, silver-haired man of means, 81 years old at the time he was questioned. I asked him if we might go into a side office where embarrassed and Mike, I told him of Mike Rodelli's accusation and asked him if he was the Zodiac Killer. He paused, then stood up, stretched out his hands in front of them, and then rubbed them together, and then began to pace back and forth, his lips thin. I wondered if this could be a sign of guilt. I also wondered if I would have reacted any differently if, out of the blue, somebody from the Metropolitan newspaper had, in effect, accused me of committing a notorious murder outside of my own house. Finally, Cavalli laughed. You can't find anybody in this city that's less likely to be the Zodiac killer than me, he said. I haven't hit anybody since I was a kid. It's Goofy, he said of Rodelli. He has nothing. This is all circumstantial nonsense in his eyes. I have a lot of assets to bring to bear, and that son of a bitch is going to be sorry that he did it. And they're talking about that, but Cavalli never did sue Rodelli. And in fact, he did agree to meet with him 5 years later. And that the article goes on for a little bit talking about these things. And I'm glad they shared some of this stuff here. And this is called The Serial Killer as a Marketing Genius. This is from the Los Angeles Review of Books. And the article was written by Tom Zollner, Zollner, just citing the source. What do you make of that description there about Cavalli's mannerisms when being questioned about this guy is saying that you are the Zodiac killer? He starts moving his hands in front of him, rubbing them together. He paces back and forth. His lips get thin. I mean, number one, do you think that is actually accurate? I don't know. That sounded pretty guilty right there. Someone's trying to think about how their big dark secret has been come out. That seems somewhat guilty. But if you listen to Cavalli's response, when he says, I haven't hit anyone since I was a kid, it's Goofy, he has nothing, this is all circumstantial in his eyes, talking about Mike Rodelli's eyes, that is, I'm definitely tempted to say that there could perhaps be some confirmation bias in Mike Rodelli's presentation on Shel Cavalli. But the thing is about this, as him as a Zodiac killer suspect, when you look at some of the things we said in part one, this is why I hope you guys will have listened to part one by now. You can go back and listen to that one at the end of this recording if you haven't heard it yet. It's really like they're looking at words that the Zodiac killer would have used, and then they're like, are there Norse connections to these words, Norwegian connections? But it's all just indirect. It's all like the word S-L-A would have been used, and that's pronounced slay, which would have been an old Norse word meaning to kill a friend. Yeah, Cavalli probably knew what that was, being a Norwegian immigrant himself, but that's just jumping to conclusions. And what I have to say about this is, number one, I think it's, I'm just a little bit suspicious about Zollner's article here. I don't know, if I saw somebody act that way, like when they were just questioned, hey, what do you think about this guy accusing you of being the Zodiac killer? And then he starts, you know, rubbing his hands together and starts pacing back and forth and his lips get thin before he answers. I would probably think that he is guilty, but I'm really glad that Tom Zollner, the author of this article, shared the idea that, now, wait a second, how would you respond if you were being accused out of the blue of being a serial killer from the 1960s? And bear in mind, we said that Cavalli would have been around 50 years old at the time of the murders, and he was 81. This is 31 years later after he would have been questioned, 31 years later after he was asked about this. But then the next thing to say about this article by Zollner is he describes the interview that happened between Shel Cavalli and Mike Rodelli. And let's just look at some of the words that have been written here. Shel Cavalli said he had no idea where he was on the date of the other murders. Not talking about the Paul Stein murder, because once again, he lived in the vicinity of that area. So he has no idea where he was on the dates of the other murders that did not happen near his house, that he didn't even read the thick report of circumstantial evidence that Rodelli had compiled for him. There wasn't much to go on, but Rodelli found him slippery on details and not vigorously protesting his innocence. But what was he supposed to do? That seemed to be that. And then that's where it says Shel Cavalli died in 2013. And 4 years after he had taken up piano lessons. And I guess that means he would have started piano at age 90, not 92, but thereabouts. I mean, it's roughly in the ballpark. Excuse me for that little detail that I misrepresented earlier. Okay, though, so the thing to say about that is I think that people who get accused of crimes that they did not commit, they can be very dismissive, and they're just like, well, obviously I'm not guilty. I mean, I've seen like this a couple instances of people being accused of being the Zodiac killer on YouTube. One was a guy that I had never even heard of. I can't even tell you his name right now. And he was just like, you're crazy. What are you talking about? And of course, we had Arthur Lee Allen discussing this on film. Maybe you've seen the one where his face is blacked out and it's just his identity is being hidden. I guess he was still Robert Hall Starr at the time. And he's just like, at times it can be horribly depressing. But many people, not only Graysmith and Don Chaney, but it's been reported that Arthur Lee Allen actually enjoyed the attention of it. I don't necessarily know. And we won't know because Allen has also passed away. Many of the major suspects in the Zodiac Killer mystery have passed away. But what do you make of Shel Cavalli's responses? I definitely have to say he does appear to be, I mean, those seem to be the actions of someone who may be guilty, but I just have to say that the case against Shel Cavalli just seems so circumstantial. Where's the hard evidence? Where are the fingerprints on Paul Stein's taxi cab? Where are the pieces of evidence at Lake Berryessa? How do you get him to the crime scenes? I mean, what is the significance of the Zodiac Killer hood? I mean, let alone, I mean, we said the hood in the first one. The Zodiac Killer symbol could be representative of Corona, California, where Cavalli raced cars for a while. The city is a circle with a cross going through it. But the big thing is, okay, that's an explanation. Where, how do you get his DNA to any of this? How do you get his fingerprints? Fingerprints and side palm print testing on the letters. Where are the hard, definitive pieces of physical evidence that would connect Cavalli to any of this? That stuff I don't see. All I see is some older man who is really caught off guard that people are accusing him of being a serial killer. And he's just like, hey, I'm a gentle guy who likes horses and I want to learn how to play the piano. And I really like cars and I'm good at selling them too. I know a lot about business. Maybe you could learn something. And that's kind of my response to Shel Cavalli. But I would love to hear your comments in the section below. If you have anything to share at all, please drop some things. And I hope you'll go back and listen to part one if you haven't heard it yet, because in part one, we more or less laid out the case talking about Shel Cavalli. And in this one, we are looking at some more critical things. So I hope you'll go back and listen to part one. The best way you can support this channel is just by listening to some more of our content. And if you like this upload, you can hit the like button. And if you haven't subscribed yet, you're welcome to do so. But most importantly, drop some comments below so we can continue the discussion. And I will see you on Instagram for the bonus podcast, BlackBoxNed88 on Instagram. Until next time.